The panel is on derivatives from space, scoping the downstream applications. So the focus of this session is going to be on applications and what are going to be the downstream applications or the societal application that we look from space. I just want to make a statement before we start off with all the panelists. I think the downstream applications coming from space could be seen in different dimensions. One is, of course, from Earth observation, the satellite images, the technology of getting data from satellites, orbiting satellites. They have tremendous applications for natural resources management, you know, disaster management, societal applications, and so on. The second downstream application which makes a real impact on society is about weather and climate, you know, about cyclones and weather and so on. Recently, India has also made the foray in its own regional navigation system and opened up possible applications for positioning satellites. Though Indian users have been using positioning systems, but with the Indian satellites, there is a tremendous opportunity for opening up downstream applications using the regional navigation systems. Of course, communications does provide the connectivity, and there's tremendous applications which we heard in the previous panel. Personalized applications of communication, commercial applications of communications, and developmental communications also. So there is a tremendous spread of downstream applications that we can consider, and hopefully the panel is going to address this, look at what is the capacity in India, what are the type of industries that are there, and what are the difficulties and challenges on this in this area. So I think I have the panel with me. Let me start off right away and request Rajesh Mathur, advisor at ESRI India, to give your views on what are the downstream applications, specifically in geographic information system as a derivative of space technology. Rajesh.
Thanks, Mukund. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to thank ORF for inviting me to come and deliver a talk over here this August gathering. I must confess, I'm the only one in this room who doesn't understand anything about space technologies. So what I'm going to talk about would be applications, as Mukund described, applications of satellite, rather space technology in building geographic information systems and how they can be deployed for the benefit of the society in general. I must say I feel a bit uncomfortable talking on this subject in the presence of my friend and former colleague, Mukund Rao, who's arguably a global expert on this subject, but I hope he'll bear with me. Let me very quickly come to the vision that ISRO has spelled out for itself, and I picked it from ISRO's website. Essentially, the focus of ISRO, as stated by them in the mission and the vision statement rather, is national development as the core purpose of the space program while pursuing space science research and planetary exploration. But clearly, national development is key priority. So what are the applications where space technology is finding use here in India? Mukund very briefly touched upon it. Earth observation, satellite communication, navigation, climate and environment, and last but not the least, disaster management. So what I'm going to talk about would be specifically in the area of Earth observation, and that's the real technology which is applied in building geographic information systems, or GIS, and deploying them across different domains. What are some of the application areas of the Earth observation satellite imagery? First and foremost, mapping. The whole notion of mapping has undergone a paradigm shift in the last couple of decades. Traditionally, focus of mapping agencies, the survey organizations and others, has been on building high quality cartographic maps. While that, of course, hasn't changed, that continues to be one of the reasons why they exist. But the product they are creating go beyond just a map on a piece of paper. What they're really doing today are creating what you may call geospatial information products, or data sets, if you will. And the reason for that, of course, is that these data sets are finding applications across different domains, and therefore user requires much more than just a physical location of an object on the Earth, but much more than the attributes and so on. So whether it's a national mapping agency building topographic maps, in our case, Survey of India, or other organizations building thematic maps, forest maps, for instance, or maybe water resources and so on and so forth. Remote sensing satellites provide extremely useful information to not only build those maps, but also have them in monitoring change on a temporal basis. It's also finding applications in water resource management and conservation, building digital elevation model DEMs and using them to do simulation and modeling, inundation modeling, flood forecasting, and so on. Of course, managing the whole storage and conservation of water resources, environment and biodiversity, forest conservation management, and other aspects of biodiversity, security, homeland security, national security, again, applications where this kind of data sets come in real useful. Building land information systems, again, foundation for a number of other information systems that countries build and deploy. Disaster management, disaster response, predicting, preparing for, and mitigating when a disaster occurs. Landslides, flooding, cyclones, and so on and so forth. Rural development across different application areas. Urban development, for that matter, in our country right now, there's a lot of talk about smart cities. And these projects can't be conceptualized and implemented unless we use satellite images to create base maps, identify opportunities for expansion, doing land use planning, and so on and so forth. And of course, core infrastructure development, roads, airports, and whatever. Indian Remote Sensing Program has played a key role in deployment of geospatial technologies, the geographic information systems, for instance, across several mission critical projects. And in the interest of time, I'll run through them very quickly. Earth science and water resources. In India, we've seen a number of projects which have been implemented, including a water resource information system built by Department of Space to project all the information that or any stakeholder would be interested in about the water resources, building land use maps, soil maps, and so on. In a number of situations when there was a disaster, this technology has been used to monitor the entire mitigation process, rehabilitation process, reconstruction process, and in some cases even predicting the impact of disaster, especially when there's a cyclone developing in, say, the Bay of Bengal, monitoring its movement using remote sensing technologies, and then predicting where the landfall will occur and what kind of intensity, and preparing and evacuating those who may come in harm's way. So the number of applications where this technology has been deployed very successfully. Also building land information systems, an extremely sensitive subject, but extremely vital. Also building conclusive land titles helps in monetization and enables landowners to monetize their land and raise money for other projects or whatever. Natural resource management, forest management, and making working plans, as they call in a country, and a number of other areas where in managing different natural resources, also going beyond natural resources, even agriculture, micro precision farming, and so on and so forth. Crop acreage prediction, forecasting, are some of the areas where these technologies have been used quite extensively and brought real benefit to all those who are interested in. Utilities, whether power distribution, water, wastewater, telecom, gas distribution, again, they benefit from taking the base maps with a lot of attribute information available in doing the network planning and network management. Transportation, whether it's port management or it's expansion planning at the airports and so on, building applications to determine what could be the building height in the vicinity of an airport, railways capacity planning, long-range planning, and so on, and building anti-accident or accident avoidance systems, and so on. Again, several areas where these technologies have been deployed very successfully. Environment assessment, of course, creating, doing impact analysis, doing what-if scenarios. If you build a dam here, what kind of reservoir will be created? What would be the land that will be filled by the reservoir? What would be the catchment area like? What would be the command area? If there's a breach, what areas are likely to be inundated and to what extent. Again, these are some of the very, very crucial applications which are used by environmentalists and administrators almost all the time. Healthcare, yet another area where, which are the areas which are prone to vector-borne disease virus development, so that corrective action can be taken to mitigate potential epidemics. And of course, moving forward, our government is working on several flagship projects announced over the last couple of years, and I think every one of them will find applications of GIS, and they were driven by high-precision, high-resolution satellite images, be it the smart cities, Amrut, which is another project of urban development ministry, land records, rural roads, hydrology project, and so on. Each of these projects will have an important role for use of geospatial technologies. I would like to conclude with a quote from Vincent van Gogh, which he made back in 1889. I think the vision he had, not the vision, really the wish I would say that he had expressed probably is going to be reality sooner than later. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Rajesh, for giving us this quick overview of the remote sensing and GIS downstream applications. I think next we'll ask Colonel Vinayak Bhat. He's an expert in military affairs, and he's going to talk on national security using satellite images. And he follows all the conflicts that happen in the world. So let's see what Vinayak Bhat has to say about world conflict and also national security as a downstream application. Vinayak.
Thank you very much, Mukund. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Due to paucity of time, I'll do less of talking and more of showing. Well, I am talking about enhancing the national security through satellite imagery. I shall be covering this in two phases, opportunities and challenges. Let's see the opportunities. They are geolocating, anti-terrorism, military modernization, military training, strategic intentions of our adversaries, the damage assessment, especially post-bombing, nuclear activities, and space denial weapons. Let's take them one by one. Geolocating. Pictures which are available in open source or internet. They have lots of background data which can be geolocated to particular locations, and thus we can derive more information out of a particular activity. Recently, we had seen a DF-41 image, which is on the left of the screen. The background buildings were clearly identified on satellite imagery. Thus, we could identify the location to Taqing in northeast of China. We could plot the view and find the exact length of that DF-41 missile to be 22.5 meters, which was unknown till then. Well, having satellite imageries of counterinsurgency area helps us in our own operations. One of the best examples is Osama bin Laden compound in Abbottabad, which was raided by the US forces. This is pre-raid image. The next one shows image of 2nd May, the morning after the raid. You can see the Pak Army vehicles carrying the helicopter remains. Little bit of the helicopter remains are still there on ground. More interesting was a mock-up which was created at Harvey Point in US 3 months before for the SEALs to practice on. Another fascinating thing was noticed in China. One of the military training establishment also has this mock-up, probably to irritate the US government. Knowing our adversary's modernization is very important in our planning and preparation of operations. This is the image of Type 94 Chin class SSBN of China. You notice 9 of its hatches are open. The configuration tells us that there are 12 tubes multiplied by the number of SSBNs. We know the SLBN capability of China. This is the Yuanwang 6 space event ship. It is meant for monitoring the missile tests. The moment it moves out of Shanghai, we know that there is something in the offing. This one is a TU-204, a testbed for J-20, the stealth aircraft of China. Notice the canards which are on top of the forward fuselage. Also notice the sharp nose cone, which has the ISAR radar. Well, this is a beautiful image captured in Shenyang Air Base. It is the Shantiao High Altitude Long Endurance UCAV. The wingspan is 42 meters, 2 meters more than the MQ-4C of the US Air Force. Now we know what kind of reach China has in fields of UCAV. This one is the PsyOps variant of Y-8. Notice the cheek fairings and the panels protruding out of the rear fuselage. On the left is the normal Y-8. We know what to train our troops for. In Paracel Islands of South China Sea, China has constructed ammunition points with high bay garages and rivetments in between. The colored rivetments, when zoomed in, one realizes there's something like textile draped over the rivetments. This is geosynthetics technology used by China to strengthen that rivetment. We have also seen deployment of HQ-9 SAMs in the same place. Here you see 4 TELs. 2 of the TELs have the launchers in vertical position, ready to fire. The other 2 are in horizontal position, but notice the sand markings behind. That shows that it was also in vertical position before capturing this image. It is important to know the damage assessment of our bombings so that we know the effectiveness of our actions. Well, Sana'a Airport is one such example. This image is pre-bombing. We know that Saudi-led Air Force started the bombing on 23rd March. The first assessment was done on 27th March. Notice 2 of the hangars destroyed. Well, that time, many of the analysts felt that this was not very effective. But come next bombing, we saw 2 more buildings destroyed. Then everybody knew that it is SIGIN targeting being done. Wherever the control moved, the exact location was being targeted. Thus, we see in the future bombings, 2 buildings have been destroyed. In this image, most of the hangars and buildings have been destroyed. Well, military training is basically preparation of war. We have to know what our adversaries are preparing for. This is image of Linyi in central China. It is the training institute of DF-21s. In the maze of trees, one can hardly see anything. But when we see the historical imagery, everything is clear. The DF-21s are deployed there for firing. Thus, we know how they will deploy in times of crisis. Well, it is very interesting and important to know what our adversaries plan. This is an example of Badumali in Shakargarh Bulge of Pakistan. You notice that the railway track and road go parallel to each other. They're slightly raised from the rest of the area. When the parliamentary attack took place, our forces moved to the border, and Pakistan got jittery and validated its plans. It put water in between the track and the road, creating an obstacle 200 meters wide. This is a sand model created by China at Helan. It is 25 kilometers south of Yantuan, which is 700 by 900 meters in size. It is a massive sand model, never seen such kind of sand models in the entire world. Well, the area depicted here is eastern Ladakh and Aksai Chin. When compared to the actual satellite imagery of the same area, you notice that the central one is Pengongso. Notice the kidney-shaped lakes. Every small little detail, every range, mountain range, is exactly the same. So we know what is the focus of China in India. Well, knowing adversaries' nuclear activities is very difficult. There are very few sources who can tell us about it. And satellite imagery is one such authentic source. This is the nuclear storage area in Hyderabad, Pakistan. Looking at it, normally it looks like a very routine military station. There are some buildings with probably some playground in between. But when you see the historical imagery, it reveals a massive underground complex. It is 2,400 square meters in size. 400 meters larger than the Albuquerque underground complex of the USA. You can imagine how many weapons he can keep there. Another tunnel storage area Pakistan has created is in Haveliyan Ammunition Depot. Notice the three tunnels going into the mountains. This is Gauri missile ready for delivery at Khan Research Labs, Kahuta. Well, NASA deployment was noticed very close to the Indian borders, 60 to 80 kilometers from the international border. The first one at Gujranwala shows DS igloos and high bay garages. The garages of 100 meter in size. He can keep almost 48 NASA TELs in this area. Well, this one is a hardened aircraft shelter in Karachi. Looking at it, it looks like any other normal hardened aircraft shelter. But when you see the historical imagery, a modern underground automated vault system is revealed. This is meant for deployment of rad missiles on their aircrafts. Everything will be automated, and most probably, it will be destruction-proof. Well, very less is known about China's progress in space denial weapons. One of the first places of space tracking was seen at Changchun, northeast of China. Notice the central dome opening for laser tracking. Next is the facility of directed energy weapons, that is the laser ASAT of China in Xinjiang. Here are three buildings with sliding roofs, and the fourth is an open shed that again slides. Well, the hypothesis is the center two are the main laser guns. The one on the left is supposedly be reserved, and the one on the right is meant for tracking. But it is also possible that all four will be used in conjunction with each other to create a very strong laser beam. Well, what are the challenges? We need to have our own satellites to get more and more imagery. We also need quick response launches, so that in case our adversary is able to affect, dazzle, disable, or destroy our satellites, we will be able to do something about it. We need more and better download facilities. We need specialists to work on particular projects, and also the organizations creating these specialists. And for all that, we need funding. To conclude, I would say readiness depends upon knowing the adversary well. And the most authentic source of knowing the adversary is satellite imagery. I leave you with a thought. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vinayak. Before I move on to the next one, I just one thought comes to me, and maybe we should get this clarified with Vinayak. I'm sure all those countries that we just now visited must also be gathering the same information of our own country and within our own domain. So how does that get factored in the national security preparations and other things? What is the view on that?
Well, we try to hide things, but it is really difficult to hide anything from the satellites. Only what is in your brains can be hidden, but not what is in the open. You can make out even whatever is under the ground. Deep under the ground also can be seen, like hyperspectral imagery we were talking about yesterday.
Okay. Thanks. So there is no more secrets in the world. So yeah. I think that's fine. So let's move on to the next speaker, Sachin Bahmba. He's the chairman and managing director of space. He's going to talk on how Earth and space observation for education, which is a very important requirement, I think, in societies across the world. Sachin.
Thank you, Mukund. Colonel Bhat, it was actually a wonderful presentation that you gave. I was a bit threatened throughout the presentation, and now it feels I should leave whatever I am doing and start working with you, to make my country safe. But anyways, in the plethora of scientists and technologists and geeks sitting in front of me, I'm going to put up a new perspective to new space. I'm going to take you off from the burden that we had from the previous presentation and probably talk about wonderful children. We work as a company who is into astronomy and space science education, and I would like to propose this as a wonderful dimension while we are working towards creating a commercially viable new space. I'm Sachin Bahmba. I'm chairman of space organization. As you can see in our motto, which is not very clear on the presentation, it is empowering life through science. So empowering here simply means to create more and more jobs and entrepreneurs who could come out as science educators and science communicators and inspire the youth who will obviously be needed by most of you sitting in this room in the years to come. Space Group, as I was very young and always fascinated by skies, had my telescope out when I was at the age of 11 and always wanted to be with the stars and planets. It started with a NGO called Space Foundation. We created an NGO but soon realized that the kind of penetration we want to have in market and the work that we want to do cannot be simply relied upon on taxpayers' money or someone who is looking forward to sponsor us. So we started creating workshops, modules, co-curricular activities, which could actually involve students into going out, observing the nature, derive numbers out of it, and learn the science the way it should be learned. Now, the first company that was born, which offered its services and product, was Space Technology and Education, the one that you see right below. When the education company was formed, slowly, we needed more educational aids. There was no possibility of finding whatever we needed to explain the various things we wanted to explain. So there was need of more educational aids, equipments, charts, books. So we created another company, which is known as Astrotech, which is sort of the manufacturing and the technical company extension of our group. Once, the workshops and other club activities took up, there was a need of developing a digital planetarium system in India, because for every 4,000 students in US, we have a planetarium system. And most of the students in our rural India are deprived of seeing a planetarium throughout life. In fact, during my journey of doing an MSc, though I learned about telescope and microscope in class 6th, but ultimately I saw a microscope and used it by class 10th, but telescope was totally missing. So that was the idea. And obviously, telescope is the first and the probably the oldest remote sensing instrument that we have studying astronomical objects. So we created LEO Planetaria, which is a digital mobile planetarium company. We are the few manufacturers who manufacture digital mobile planetariums all around the world. And our strength is not manufacturing a digital mobile planetarium, because that is much cheaper. You can get it much cheaper from China. The point is that, you know, we have our planetarium shows created in almost all languages of India, and that is where the edge of science popularization comes. Slowly, the step was obvious to take into astrotourism, where people wanted to go out and see eclipses and various astronomical events that were happening. So we started making tours, and we have tours for hunting meteoroids and so on and so forth happening in India. So a lot and lot people joined us, and slowly what we started as a small initialization went into a big industry. Obviously, when astrotourism took over, the space, exploring the Earth from space and exploring the Earth again was a natural step to take, so Space Earthnaut was born. And finally, we now have created a facility called Astroport, which is a space and astronomy themed resort. It is just 4 hours journey from Delhi, and the panelists are welcome to join if they would like to visit it sometime. Now, this is the few pictures of showing education, outreach, foundation activities, astrotourism, digital planetarium, and finally the astroport. And you can see the Milky Way behind the astroport. It is a wonderful site to visit. Now, idea in showing you all of this that has happened is something else. The idea is, when we started to go out for education, we needed more enterprise to come in. So the point I want to make here is, when you want to educate kids, which are in huge number, you don't have to think of companies for which you have to look for buyers. There are buyers out there. So creating a science popularization or an education company should be on agenda of new space initiatives that we are going to take. Now, other than new business possibilities that I'm talking about, especially for the countries who do not have a footprint yet into space technologies, probably space education and astronomy education is a wonderful opportunity for them to take up. There are a lot of rewards also in starting an education company, and you will see as my presentation proceeds that this is a wonderful one of the projects that we do with kids. It's called All India Asteroid Search Campaign, and we get data from telescopes which are all situated in US, and that data is analyzed by students. They download the data and look for the moving objects with a special technique using a software, and they report back that what kind of moving objects they have seen, and they test it whether they are asteroids or not. And then finally, it leads to a discovery, and the astronomer who has given that data shares the credit of the discovery with the kid. So right now I want to tell you that there are around 40 discoveries that have been done by Indian students. This year itself, since we are getting data from a better telescope, out of the 614 discoveries done all around the world, 518 discoveries are from Indian students. So this is a few of the telescopes that I am talking about. And you know, then another interesting project that students do is the Internet Telescope Project. Obviously, the telescopes are not in India, and I would come to that point later on. But it is wonderful for kids to take these photographs. These are generally high school, junior school students and college students who take these photographs using the remote telescopes. Few photographs taken by our students. Then this is a very famous project funded by NASA called Celluride EarthCam project. Our students have taken these photographs using the camera that is mounted on International Space Station. This is something I told you about, the 40 discoveries of asteroids that have been done by Indian students. In fact, the first discovery of the 2 asteroids done in 2016 is being named this year. So they will have a fair chunk of space named on their name. We are also doing a project called Sky on Bike, funded by Indian Astronomical Union, International Astronomical Union, as well as we are on the expert committee, which is renovating our old observatories called Jantar Mantar. Now, few achievements that we have done that have made history in India is one of the largest observation that we conducted. I don't know you can make it or not. There are 1,84,000 people, 1.4 lakh people looking at solar eclipse of 2009 in Bihar in Taregana. In fact, they stopped a train and everybody climbed on a train to look at the eclipse. The second photograph is the first flight that followed. It's the first passenger flight that followed solar eclipse in India, though the flights have been done by military along with the government astronomical agencies, but it was the first ever passenger flight done in India on 22nd July 2009. And we have also done the first cruise that went to went in Indian Ocean in 2010 to watch the annular solar eclipse. Again, the point I want to make that none of the projects have originated in India. So we see that there is a lot of data. There are a lot of technocrats. I think almost worldwide Indians are the biggest contributors of this technology. But there are no projects initiated in India of this sort. I would like to give a call to this house to come out, to start sharing data with us. I know that data is sacred for you. But you know, once you have used it, it's a wonderful thing for us to use it as a tool to give out to students, and they can do wonderful things with them. Now, I want to also tell that before any project starts creating job for people, you know, science failed or science successful creates a job for a communicator. So you should start thinking about creating education companies in your countries and possibilities of this sort, what we have done. Now, also it was very evident from the few slides that I showed you that the growth in education does not restrict to just to creating jobs for science communicators and popularizers. It also has spillovers to other service providers, particularly the travel agency, travel companies, and it creates more business and revenues and jobs for everyone. Now, talking to the topic today, which is new space, I probably was able to put a little light on the possibility of adding few ventures of education into what we are all looking at. Because education, educating the youth in the new space domain will create jobs in new space region for non-technical enthusiasts of space. I assure you there are a lot many people who are enthusiastic in space and they cannot be technocrats or, you know, cannot do engineering or cannot do startups. It's very nice for them to find jobs into what they love through organizations like us. It obviously tends to the capacity building and it creates awareness in students and public about new space issues in India. I think you know, most of the companies that get successful put up a lot of money in going for outreach, probably, you know, giving a small component to education, opening up your facility for us. Letting us create a small module around your facility would help creating more jobs and would be a wonderful outreach for all of you. Now, India's vision is in remote sensing, meteorology, weather forecasting for agriculture, positioning and navigation, GIS, and my vision is to use the data generated by India to create workshops and possibilities for graduate and undergraduate students. And this commercialization of such industries are creating entrepreneurs and employment opportunities. So when you say that we are looking at increasing capacity of India to meet national requirements in domains, which I just mentioned, I think targeting the youth, enrolling the youth, and inspiring them is also a capacity building that we need to do. Now, with most of the activities that we do are running in the cities like Delhi and Mumbai and, you know, other metropolitans and A-class and B-class cities, the possibility to take our activities to rural India, where a child who is also sparked, a child who is not maybe as literate as a child in a city, but as educated as any other child in any city, has his own problems. Probably, you know, if these students can go out and talk to those students, which they generally do, I think there would be more problems that we will be putting forward in front of this esteemed gathering, and probably there would be more solutions than just we, than the solutions that we just right now identify. Now, broadening, so integrating these possibilities together in India means that we have to bring the education as well as the technical startups and industries and technocrats that are looking forward to do something in new space. And there are a few offerings that I would like to make. Please open up your facilities for us. My specific request to, you know, ISRO has started working with us. In fact, the students who discovered asteroid in 2010, the whole team went and met ISAC Center. And you know, open your facilities for us to create new possibilities for these students. Participate in our panels as experts, talk to these kids, come out, create possibilities, create projects for them, and let us take those projects to youth. Guide us in possible projects and trainings that can be done. Probably these trainings will help you to have a trained resource while you are looking for. Then if there is a possibility of internship in various startups and companies and projects, we would love to have our students getting enrolled for it. And one important thing, we have around 200,000 students on our rolls. Now, when you are doing remote sensing, obviously you need data validation. And that is where we offer this resource. We have actually proven to the scientific community that once the data is open to students, they can do wonders. Probably, you know, you can also take advantage of this huge number of ground citizen scientists who can be used to validate the data that you are generating. So, so as I said, industry can bank on extensive student network and educational resource of space for their data validation. We can validate your satellite imagery by actual observations at ground, which are possible by students. What they look forward is just a certificate coming from your organization that they have participated in this kind of project. And industry can depend on students growing as resource for as their and taking up new space as their possible career. And obviously, we can create a lot of outreach for your industry by opening up facilities and centers that we have established already in India, all over country. So concluding that education industry growth should have synergy with the new space, and it can create new jobs and new entrepreneurs. There are ideas around to 8th class, 9th class, 10th class students, which might actually make you think again. So open up the data generated for education. As I said, the most of the projects are initiating and starting from foreign countries. We look forward to people in India to open up their data and involve students in using this data and doing something wonderful and service to science. Use our students as resource for ground-based observation and data validation. Students can identify new problems for this industry. When we go out and talk to students, they are very innovative. They come out both with solution and ideas. Since we started working in astronomy and space science, you know, I have seen 8 students of just 15 years of age achieve 8 patents. So, you know, they have been coming out with ideas, though they are not yet related to space industry, so probably you don't know about them, but you know, they have come out with wonderful things. Once they have been introduced to these kind of tools which are available to all of you, and most of us take them for granted. So restructure your data flow, and probably, you know, as PanSTAR has done in Hawaii, probably the morning an astronomer uses the telescope, and in the evening the telescope is available to students in India, because when there is evening in US, that's morning in India. So probably just by, you know, thinking a little open-minded and opening up your facility, there could be wonders that could be done by education in the area of new space. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you, Sachin. That was really very interesting, and I think we'll have some points for discussion later. Let's move on to the next panelist, George Sibley. He's the Minister Counselor in the U.S. Embassy on Economic Environment and Science and Technology. I think he's going to talk on U.S.-India Space Cooperation as far as space applications are concerned.
Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here. It's great to see all of you. I would like to comment, first of all, Ms. Bhamba. I think it's fantastic to stress the potential for students and the need for data access. I'm going to echo that. I'm going to also go back to Colonel Bhat. He spoke about the competition between countries, in fact, hostile competition, in fact, warfare. I'm going to talk about another aspect of international relations that is in cooperation rather than competition, and perhaps that will include how we can provide data for the students in India and in the United States and perhaps indeed around the world. Before we start, because this is right after lunch and we're all sleepy and it's a little easy to get sort of bogged down, I'm going to just throw out a couple of dates and see if you can guess what events I'm talking about. So today is February 17th. So how about December 17th? Does anybody have any idea what happened on a particular December 17th that was noteworthy? December 17th. I'll give you a hint. We're talking over 100 years ago. 1903, December 17th. Somebody, please, now I've given it away. Kitty Hawk, correct. For the first time, human beings flew. Powered flight. They achieved the magnificent altitude of 20 feet. That's a little under 7 meters. They traveled for the magnificent distance of 120 feet. That's under 40 meters, and it took 12 seconds. I visited Kitty Hawk when I was a little kid, and I actually ran the distance a little bit faster, I think, although perhaps as I look at these numbers, I wonder if the family that took me there might have fudged it for me to make me feel better that I had gone faster than the Wright brothers. But that was pretty significant. 1903 is not that long ago. My grandparents were alive in 1903. They were also alive, this is an easy one, they were also alive on July 21st. Come on, everybody's got to know this one. 1969, yes. So 1969, Neil Armstrong steps down and he says either that was a small step for man or a small step for a man, and a giant leap for mankind, or humankind as we would now say. So within that space of my grandparents' lifetime, we've gone from never having been on powered flight to actually walking on the moon. And the other thing is, I don't have any idea when my grandparents would have found out or their parents would have found out about Kitty Hawk. Maybe it was weeks or months later, probably via telegraph or something like that. And yet, I was sitting in my grandparents' living room watching on television while Neil Armstrong was stepping down onto the surface of the moon. So the we talk about downstream applications, the communications capacity. Fantastic, fantastic. All right, so I just wanted to throw that history out there and wake you up a little bit because I'm going to talk a little bit about India and the United States and the cooperation we have on space. And it began before Neil Armstrong stepped onto the moon, 1963, when India first launched a U.S.-manufactured sounding rocket, also known as a research rocket, from Tumba in Kerala to study the atmosphere above the Earth's magnetic equator. 1963. In the 70s, ISRO and NASA conducted the Satellite Instructional Television Experiment, which involved using NASA's first direct broadcasting satellite to beam educational television programming to over 2,400 villages in India. Now we're getting to the applications for your students. It's followed by the establishment of the Indian National Satellite, INSAT, system in the 1980s, of which the first four INSAT satellites were built by U.S. industry, and three of them were put into orbit by U.S. launch vehicles. Which kind of brings us now to the current cooperation. ISRO's Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, the PSLV, is a proven and reliable launch system. And another date, February 15th, just a few days ago, we had the 35th consecutive successful launch by the PSLV carrying 104 satellites. I didn't do the research, I should have. How many years from the first satellite to the 104th satellite that was put up there? But I am sure we're talking decade, maybe? They did it in one single launch. And of those 104, I would add, 96 were U.S. satellites, including 88 Earth imaging satellites, which they called Dove satellites, from the U.S. company Planet Labs. And Colonel Bhat, doves are the symbol of peace. These are the Dove satellites. We have NISAR, the NASA ISRO Synthetic Aperture Radar, set to launch in 2021. We're in the process of putting together the technology package to make this work. And it's going to use advanced radar imaging to observe and to take key measurements of the Earth's complex systems to study natural hazards and global environmental change, which our first speaker highlighted. So this is all kind of wrapping together a bit here. So it'll be able to measure surface deformations, determine the likelihood of earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, landslides, also be able to analyze changes in sea ice, snow extent, permafrost, and surface melting to determine how climate and ice masses interrelate and raise the sea level. Very important stuff as we think about the impact of climate change that is roaring towards us. This program will carry two synthetic aperture radars, an L-band radar provided by NASA and an S-band radar provided by ISRO. And don't anybody ask me what the L and S-band stands for because I don't know. All right, but they operating on these two bands does provide greater flexibility in measurements and thereby expands the scientific objectives of the mission. And the intent is for these to be launched by the other major launch vehicle of ISRO, the geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle, GSLV. We've worked together on weather collaboration under a memorandum of understanding from 2008 between NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, and India's Ministry of Earth Sciences. And both sides have endorsed the study of climate variability through oceanic and atmospheric observations, as well as remote sensing applications. We are collaborating together on the Monsoon Deck, which is held at the United States National Centers for Environmental Protection. And it was created in 2011 to share numerical models on simulations and diagnostics with institutions under MOES for real-time weather and climate forecasting, which then feeds into agricultural advisories sent to nearly 300,000 farmers in Hindi and a variety of other vernacular languages. And before I move off of the monsoon desk, I would just point out, when we think about climate change, I would venture that probably there is no country more vulnerable in the world than India. Because if you think about the importance, the central importance of the monsoon on the economy and the well-being of India, a fairly modest change in that monsoon could have a tremendous impact on not just millions, but actually over a billion people. I will now move from the Earth into the solar system. NASA and ISRO collaborate on exploring the solar system. That includes Moon, Mars, and the Sun. So the Chandrayaan-1, which was India's first mission to the moon in 2008, had two NASA scientific instruments on it, one of which mapped about 90% of the surface of the moon in 9 months, and has led scientists to discover water molecules in the moon's polar region that can have very significant implications long term. Mars. In 2014, the United States and India both established the Mars Working Group to explore cooperation on respective Mars missions. And we both countries used the proper gravitational alignment to send orbiters to Mars, ISRO's Mars Orbiter mission. When I told my wife that the mom had been successful, she says, "Moms are always successful." And NASA's Mars Atmospheric and Volatile Evolution mission, MAVEN, they arrived in Martian orbit within 2 days of each other in September 2014. So the Mars group seeks to share information on observations and scientific analysis and to explore the possibility of conducting a joint future Mars mission. Finally, I mentioned the Sun. This past fall, both countries have agreed to start a heliophysics working group to conduct joint studies on the effect of the Sun in the solar system. So, what is the key to this successful collaboration? In 2017, sometime later this year, the United States and India will hold the sixth biennial U.S.-India Civil Space Working Group, where both countries will set our priorities for areas for space cooperation. So if you have any ideas, be sure to send those ideas to Andrea Robles, who's sitting back here with her hand up. when we get together, we're going to think about where we've come in the last 54 years since 1963, and think about where we might go in the next 54 years. And one of the things that we have focused on has been workforce development, and the other thing has been, and this is what you emphasized, a growing commitment to share information with the public. On workforce, the Professional Engineer and Scientist Exchange Program facilitates the exchange of NASA and ISRO-sponsored engineers and scientists. And these encourage greater scientific collaboration and spur new areas of collaboration. In addition, at the university level, ISRO funds fellowships for top-ranking graduates from the Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology, IIST, to pursue masters in space engineering at Caltech and NASA JPL, which is managed by Caltech, and since 2015 has been accepting 3 students per year for 2-month internships at the Jet Propulsion Laboratories, JPL. Finally, on open data, NASA's mandate is that any information coming from a NASA satellite will be made available to the public within a few days of receipt. Let me say that again. NASA's mandate is that any information coming from a NASA satellite will be made available to the public within a few days of receipt. For your students. All right? Therefore, any joint project with ISRO that uses federal money falls under the same requirement. So from December 2015 to March 2016, NASA and ISRO conducted the VIRUS-NG India campaign. And this campaign used a NASA spectral imaging instrument to fly over 57 pre-selected sites in India to map coastal zones, mangroves, forests, and agricultural zones. And the data collected, which is openly available on ISRO's Space Application Center website, will play a key role on Indian and US scientists and students of whatever age to understand global environmental change. So in conclusion, as we talk about downstream applications, the ability to develop them and to use them is going to be critical if you have open data. The more data available to work with allows more and more opportunities and more creativity on the part of a greater number of people. So if I'm making a little bit of a pitch here, forgive me, but I would absolutely echo your point. Data provided is data that can be useful. Data that is withheld is data that is not going to be useful. So I look forward to a fruitful program here today for all of you and over the next couple of days, and more especially a very, very fruitful collaboration between the United States and India over the next 50, 60, 70 years. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, George. I think what you have outlined is a subject matter of one full conference, and there could be a dialogue on that itself, but I'm sure there'll be some questions. Let's move on to the last speaker that we have, Prateep Basu. He's an analyst at the Northern Sky Research, and he's also going to talk on the commercial applications of geographic information systems.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I must say it's difficult to follow up to some really great presentations that we have been witnessing for the last 1 hour. So as Dr. Mukund said, I'm representing Northern Sky Research, which is a Boston-based market research and consulting firm focused on satellite and space industry. We are a small team of 15 individuals from around the world, and with a combined experience of 150 years or more. As you can see, we are based out of US, and we are in South America, India, Europe, and in East Asia. So being a knowledge company, we focus on 4 main areas of the satellite industry: communications, space applications, space infrastructure, and the financial analysis of the space industry. I would love to take you through those small font written stuff, but maybe that's time something we could do during the coffee session. So coming to the point of today's discussion, which is applications of commercial geospatial intelligence. Before we take a look at what are the various applications, let's take a step back and see what is the natural resource of this industry. And that's data, something that was emphasized by George. Now, the Earth observation industry has been traditionally a very government-focused industry, but in 1992, a company called Digital Globe, Denver-based company, they came up and started supporting the US government. And now currently, as you can see from this slide, own together along with Airbus, another big OEM, about 65% of the commercial Earth observation industry. The size of the industry is very small. It's like 1/10 of two of the biggest satellite communications operator in the world. Like, let's say it's Intelsat and SES, they probably make $15 billion a year. But it's the structure of this industry which is very important to understand while we look at the commercial applications and the business opportunities that the geospatial industry provides. Now, when you look at this map on the right-hand side of the chart, you'll see that 85% of the revenues is made in three regions of the world, primarily led by North America, then Europe, and Asia. So the nature of this industry, as we see it, the commercial industry is very concentrated, both at the regional level and also at the commercial operator level. While we try to analyze how this industry is structured, it's good to always look at granular structuring of the industry. So at NSR, we do this study in seven different vertical markets: defense and intelligence, managed living resources, which consist of applications like agriculture, forestry, fisheries, energy, and natural resources, which has applications like asset monitoring for energy exploration, geological surveys, industrial surveying, for utilities, transportation, shipping, telecommunication towers, services, which is mostly related to the financial and the tourism, leisure side of stuff. And finally, civilian government usage. There is one thing in blue that we have recently added, which is a commercial weather vertical. As we know, in US, some startups like Spire, GeoOptics, and Planet IQ, they have come up thanks to a program by NOAA to have commercial data sets support the government data sets. Now, the thing is, today we are speaking of this industry as in different segments, but we are in the middle of a data revolution. Now, big data is a very it's a big jargon nowadays. Everyone says we are a big data company, but the essence of this entire big data revolution is that no services will exist in isolation. Everything is being lumped together. No one wants to buy weather data. They want to have weather data with location and geospatial data. If someone to have with tracking data. And with advances in computing technology and the moving of artificial intelligence from college laboratories to actual commercialization has paved way for a very interesting path ahead for the geospatial industry. Now, having looked at the natural resource, the data, and who are the data providers, and what kind of markets we are looking at, this chart here tries to show us what kind of data are we generating today commercially, and what kind of applications we are unlocking. So if you may see, that is the region which is very concentrated. And in the geospatial industry, the two parameters that we'll use to set this kind of benchmarking is the resolution, image resolution that we are using, and the revisit frequency. Now, most of the satellite constellations that we see today, constellations or fleet at times, will be somewhere in between 1 to 5 meter of resolution, because under 1 meter resolution, there is always regulatory issues, not in the US, but in other countries. And revisit time has taken a new importance where things change so fast, so we need to do this change detection. The company that was mentioned, Planet Labs, yes, they recently launched 88 satellites. Now they will be having about 138 satellites imaging the Earth and every point of Earth every 30 minutes a day. So we are basically generating lots and lots of data, and it's the time where we have to ingest that data, make meaningful information out of it so that people can actually use it. So for example, Planet Lab, it generates more than 1 TB of data in a day. 1 TB of data. So how do we use that much data? What kind of infrastructure is required, and what type of applications can we generate? That's what I'll take you through three examples in the coming slides. First one is agriculture. It's always good to start with something very pragmatic and something which has been neglected for long, especially in the developing parts of the world. Now, speaking of open data, here is an example. Thank you to USA. Landsat data is available for free. It's 30 meter in ground resolution. Amazing pictures. And also European Space Agency has its own Copernicus program, which provides really good data for usage in agriculture vertical market especially. And these two open data programs have been a major driver for creation of variety of applications in this vertical, especially in the downstream segments. And that's one of the examples that I'm showing in the left side of this slide. Gone are the days when we are going to take a satellite image and process it, correct it, and provide an NDVI analysis. No one wants that today, because what we need is actual actionable intelligence. And that is what companies today are trying to achieve. And it's again, a very US-dominated market today, where the main companies working on these in this market specifically are based out of Silicon Valley. So definitely, you know, cooperation and stuff we can talk about in the question-answer session. What you see here is basically a crop detection and yield estimation being done using deep learning algorithms, where you have an image mask created, you do the edge detection, and then run algorithms to calculate the yield, and not just calculate the yield, but also predict the yield, and provide this service to any user who can just open, like give in a login format, and see how much yield his farm is producing, what is the percentage of his farm that's you know, having nice, good soil characteristics, well watered. So essentially, you are providing a satellite to every farmer, every person who is in the agriculture field. And this is something that is the essence of the entire downstream applications of space. Space, if you look, it's like a pyramid. Sorry, it's like a pyramid. And mostly we keep focused on the space segment, you know, make remote sensing satellites, keep on improving the resolution, but we forget the huge applications and the huge market that this creates. So we at NSR keep estimating the potential, the market potential, looking at the different demand and supply sides, and estimate that this industry itself will be generating revenues of more than 800 million in annually, which is a combination, which is going to be a combination of satellite and UAV images, something we can have a separate conference on, but primarily by satellite. The next one example is how geospatial intelligence is being used by financial sector. So you see two images. One is of Nathan Light. It's a geospatial software used by Munich Re. And the other one is a very interesting concept of estimating oil prices that the commodities and hedge funds on the Wall Street are now adopting by using satellite images. This source from the company called Orbital Insights. So by having satellite data, which is global in nature itself, you know, which is why I'm not speaking of just India here, because this is a global business, it's a global opportunity. And the combination of this geospatial data with location and financial data is helping create services for the financial sector to gain business intelligence and optimize their cost of administration. And we estimate just this industry to bring in revenues of more than $5.5 billion in the next 10 years. And just to make one thing clear, how the business is evolving, this is no more a pixel business. You know, you don't care whether it's taken from expensive digital globe satellite or a planet satellite. It's an information business today. The last example, and some of us have touched before, is the geospatial intelligence being used for civilian government users. Considering the number of emergency response requests we are getting, especially due to climate change or whatever the world believes, We estimate that satellite data will continue to be in demand for purposes such as fire detection, maps, flooding, and damage assessment, as you can see in these images, and contribute to a market globally of about 643 million in annual revenues, which is the current size, to about more than 1.2 billion by 2025. So, to summarize, if you see this chart, and I've been speaking only on numbers, being a market analyst, if you cut the industry into the data, the value-added services, which is basically a level one, level two product, and the other stuff, information products and the analytics part of it, where you fuse data, where you fuse large quantities of data, that's what is going to bring 55% of the industry revenues in the coming 10 years. And this is where every country businesses, they have to create policies, they have to open up to business opportunities, which is upcoming, because today India here, a company is not able to procure Digital Globe images without going through a lot of paperwork. But if he gets access from Digital Globe's cloud infrastructure and he just provides some analytics, some bar chart or pie chart, is it illegal? So these are all questions that has to be answered, and to look at the possibilities that this kind of business opens up. There are so many projects that the Indian government has taken, like smart cities, river cleaning, reforming of agricultural practices. So it's exciting times, calls for cooperation, calls for a certain amount of policy and regulatory jig. And with this, I would like to close my presentation. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Please don't ask me why there's a Manhattan picture when we are based in Boston.
Thank you. Thank you, Prateep, for giving that insight into the way the business of geospatial technology and remote sensing is going through. I think we are already ahead of time. Raji is already pointing us to vacate the space. But I think I will still take three questions, if possible. Quick questions to any of the panelists. Keep it brief. One-liners, and please address it to whom you want to ask. Yeah, plus.
Hi, my name is Kartik. So I guess I'm asking both Mr. Vinayak and Sir George. You both presented two sides of a coin of cooperation and conflict in, to some extent. I'm just wondering if you could talk about how those spheres merge, or are they mutually exclusive, or do you see any diplomacy and militaristic sides sort of coming together in terms of technology, policy, diplomacy?
Yeah, please, quick.
Quick. First, I must say I stand for peace through kinetics. Okay. It's not that I am only for conflict. Well, secondly, what you asked, they can go hand in hand. In case we have a GIS, we can always fuse these things. Whatever data we produce, it can be fused in a GIS. And yes, diplomats also can use it for their advantage. They know what is happening in which area. And the way you want to project your own things, you can always do that. And it happens. Right. It happens, especially, I'll give you an example. During Kargil, when Pakistan denied that their forces were there, satellite imagery was shown to them by US and told, okay, here are your troops. So that kind of diplomacy does take place.
Okay. George, do you have to add anything on this point?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's pretty well known. The US and India cooperate in a broad range of areas, including on military cooperation of various kinds. But as far as, you know, sort of the more global picture that you're describing, I think you need to just recognize that with every new technology, there are uses that can be put to it that that maybe require careful restriction, and others that need to be made more open. And we had a gentleman who from COPUOS, right, the peaceful use of space. It requires us as a global citizens to find a way to come together in such a way that we preserve space as a peaceful arena insofar as it's possible to do so.
Thanks. Any other question from anybody? Okay, I think I can't resist asking this question, finding George on this table. I know that India and US have been collaborating quite a long time, as you described, right from 63 onwards. And in 2004, there was a conference which set the civilian and commercial collaboration that was in a conference that was held in Bangalore. Why is industry collaboration and commercial participation of Indian and US industry not happening? But on the agency side, there's a lot of things happening. But why are industry-related collaborations and cooperations not happening between the two countries?
Well, so I don't think there's an inherent obstacle. I think the question becomes, you know, it's part of, you know, Prime Minister Modi speaks about ease of doing business. And you look at the World Bank rankings, you know, there are some areas in which India could improve to move up the ranking on ease of doing business. And I think if some of those regulatory and legal hurdles were removed, U.S. and India business cooperation across all domains, but including in this domain, would improve rather quickly.
Thanks. I think I don't have anything more, unless any of the panelists have any last statements to say. Okay, thanks a lot, and it was a very interesting panel.